briefly about my work on this theoretical study of graphene nanoribbons. Graphene nanoribbons have generally been described as long, thin strips of graphene. I hope you will see by the end of this that that's not entirely true these days. They've been studied extensively theoretically, and they generally come in three basic flavours when this is done. The first is the zigzag nanoribbon, so cool because it has a zigzag edge. The second, well, the next two are armchair nanoribbons, and I think if you squint a bit, you can kind of see the edge looks like an armchair. These come in two flavours. There is the odd type, where you have different numbers of rings as you move along the length, and the even type, where you have the same number, but they mesh slightly differently. Now, these were generally considered because they have very interesting electro and magnetic properties. But to actually see those properties in experiment, you need an atomically precise structure. And this was not really possible from the methods that were being used to produce them. Most of these methods were top-down, where you start with graphene and then you etch it with some sort of lithographic technique. And this doesn't result in these perfect structures, so the electrical properties were not controlled. This led to a number of chemists seeking methods to produce these structures using a bottom-up approach. And there, 8 years ago, there was some success in this field, but an alternative structure was also produced by these experiments, which the people called Chevron-type nanoribbons. These structures exist. They're produced using self-assembly of monomers on a surface, followed by a dehydrogenation step. And we're kind of interested in these from their mechanical point of view rather than their electrical point of view. If you take a structure like this and you apply force to either end, you will get out-of-plane buckling, and the corners will sort of move out of plane, and you get a non-linear displacement relationship. So ideally, we could use these as a reinforcement particle for a polymer, but this requires, ideally, to bond it into the polymer network using covalent functionalisation. So that is where, what I have been looking at in my studies. To do this, we took a single hydrogen atom as an analogue for the functional group we want to attach, and attached it to the various sites within a periodic system. And here are the results. The basic takeaway from this this picture is that if you attach your functional group to the edges, you will get a lower formation energy than if you attach it to the middle. What this means is if you're functionalizing this using some stochastic method, your functional group will stick onto any atom, but it will generally migrate across to the edge and then stay attached to the edge. And you can see there are certain sites, the more blue the sites are, the more likely you are to have an attachment. Sorry. The problem with this particular study is that it only considers a single atom. This creates an odd number of electrons, which means this is a radical structure. You have an unpaired electron and it's really highly reactive, so it's not necessarily very realistic of a final functionalized nanoribbon. So we then moved on to looking at two-site functionalization. If you can look, you should be able to see these grey atoms that moves across in these different plots. We attached a single hydrogen atom to that site and then attached a second one to the other site, and that's how we get the heater formation colouring for the other dots. The lowest conformation you can see is this one here. So if you have a functional group attached to a pair of these sites, then you have that is the more likely structure that you will get. But actually, this structure, you know, having a something attached down here onto these interior atoms, it gives you is generally a more probable outcome. This is all very good and will hopefully lead into simulations of these structures in polymer. But the further work we need to perform is to look at the effect of functional group density. We know roughly where they're likely to attach, but how likely are they to attach as you increase the number of functional groups on the molecule? We'd also like to have a look at the impact on mechanical properties of this functionalization process, but both of these steps has required us to really look at new methods for modeling. we need to look at quite a large system of atoms, and the methods we've used so far don't allow us to do that. So we've run into a few problems looking at things like material failure, and this is really driving the next phase of our work. I'll just say thank you. Oh dear. Thank you very much.